Why don't we get started? My name is Frank Schwartz, and I'm the president of Showa Boston Institute. I'd like to welcome you all for joining us today. It has been 70 years since the end of the Pacific War, and it's a time for many retrospectives. Today, we're going to look back at how the status of women in Japan has changed over the last seven decades. Before we begin, I would like to thank our co-sponsors, the Program on U.S.-Japan Relations and the Reischauer Institute, both here at Harvard. I'd like to give special thanks to Professor Susan Farr and Shinji Fujihira, Bill Nering, Lauren Inch, Jenny Kim, and at the Reischauer Institute, Professor Wes Jacobson, Ted Gilman, and Stacy Matsumoto. Without all of the time and effort they put into this event, it would not have been possible. So we are very grateful. Now, opening remarks today will be delivered by Mariko Bando. She is a pioneering role model, a highly sought after speaker, and a leading advocate for women's rights, who now serves as president and chancellor of Showa Women's University in Tokyo. That is to say that I have the good fortune that she is my boss. She worked in the Japanese government in various capacities for 34 years, earning such positions as the first female career bureaucrat in the Prime Minister's office and the first woman to serve as Consul General. Ms. Bando is a prolific author whose book, Dignity of a Woman, has sold more than 3 million copies and was Japan's number one bestseller in the year 2007. If I could speak from experience to give you an idea of the status that she holds in Japan, during her last trip here in Boston, she came to celebrate with our students' Coming of Age Day. We had a dinner to mark the occasion. And when Bando-san tried to leave the dinner, a group of students ran up and asked if they couldn't have their picture taken with her. And of course, she graciously agreed. And as soon as those students stepped aside, another group of students ran up and asked to have their picture taken. And another, and another, and another. It took her 15 minutes to leave the room. But with that, I will give you Bando-san.
Thank you, Frank, for a very, very kind introduction of me. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Showa Women's University, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to Consul General Himeno, Professor Susan Farr, our keynote speaker, Representative Noda Seiko, and to all the panelists and moderators who have gathered here, some from across the continent, some from across the Pacific Ocean. All of them are people who have used their influence to improve the status of women. This year, 2015, is the 70th anniversary of the end of the Pacific War. There will be many ceremonies, events, and political discussions around the world. We hope to join these discussions and present a new perspective from the viewpoint of women. I can't believe that when the war ended, Japanese women had no suffrage, no opportunity to get higher education, no access to equal jobs. After the war, however, women won the right to vote, and new constitution declared that men and women are equal under the law. Japanese education system, civil court, and labor standard law were all revised. We are grateful that many American women in the occupation headquarters worked with feminist female leaders in Japan to promote women's rights. Ms. Beate Shirota, who served on General MacArthur's staff and whose work has been highlighted by women in Professor Susan Farr, was responsible for the promotion of the status of women in Article 14th and 24th of the new Constitution. Thereafter, American women, scholarly insights, and feminist movement, and corporate executives, and lawmakers have strongly stimulated the cause of women in Japan. In addition, many Japanese women who earned advanced academic degree in the United States, like Dr. Sumiko Iwao, have led women to change Japanese societies. I myself was greatly inspired and motivated by my study here in Banting Institute. It's nearly 40 years ago, where I got to know so many women who work so hard and bravely to contribute to this society and make it better, a place to live and enjoy equality and peace. After 70 years, we Japanese women continue to advance and to increase our participation in the political, economic, social, and cultural field. More than 55% of Japanese girls receive higher education, and we enjoy the longest longevity in the world. But we still do not participate equally in the decision-making positions in politics, in government, corporations, even in our communities. According to the Global Gender Gap Index, Japan ranks number 104th out of 135 countries in the world. So we are still on the halfway for equality. Womanomics, or the equalization of gender role in the workforce, which have been championed by Ms. Kyashi Matsui, is an integral part of Prime Minister Abe's politics to revitalize the Japanese economy. This symposium will examine how women's economic, social, and political status have improved in post-war Japan, and what we can do in the next stage to eliminate remaining obstacles. I hope this discussion will suggest ideas to make that happen. Finally, I would like to express my sincere appreciation again to Professor Susan Farr and her Harvard colleagues, and Consul General Himeno, and to Ms. Inazawa of Yomiuri Newspaper, and to all of the participants gathered here. Thank you again. I have a privilege to introduce Representative Noda Seiko-san. She is very young, liberal Japanese politicians who are fighting together with us to improve the status of women in Japan. Please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me at today's symposium. I'd like to extend my sincere appreciation to President Mariko Bando of Showa Women's University and to Harvard University for organizing this special event. Recent surveys show that the relationship between the American and Japanese people is extremely good. In addition, last week, Prime Minister Abe became the first leader of Japan to address Congress. Two countries have been able to maintain such a good relationship because together we have struggled with and solved a variety of issues over the last 70 years. In the future, it is my earnest hope that we will continue to cooperate in the midst of a rapidly changing world, whatever domestic issues each country faces. After the end of the Pacific War, the U.S.-Japan relationship began on the basis of democracy and an improvement in the status of women. Democracy necessarily values human rights and made possible the voting rights the Japanese women had demanded for so many years. As a result, men started to recognize women as full citizens of Japan and as partners. Nowadays, you can find female politicians at every level of government, villages, towns, and cities, to the Diet. Nevertheless, despite the achievement of female suffrage, the reality is that the number of female politicians is still small, perhaps in part because it was not a development that most men desired. In the first post-war election, 39 women won election. 70 years after the end of the war, the number of the female Diet members is only 45. It is surprising that the current situation is so little different now from what it was 70 years ago. Japan ranks as one of the worst countries in the world in terms of its utilization of women, as she mentioned, and low female involvement in political activities negatively affects policies of interest to women, such as wage differentials, the sexual harassment that never seems to stop, and the increase of single parenting caused by domestic violence, which has resulted in an increase in childhood poverty. On health issues, female-specific cancers have not attracted sufficient public interest, and because awareness programs have failed, the number of deaths caused by these cancers has been increasing. In Japan, female workforce participation by age describes an M-shaped curve. In other words, the rate of female employment drops when women quit jobs to give birth and become full-time mother in their 30s. The problem is that when such women try to re-enter the labor force when their child-rearing duties lighten, they cannot return to full-time jobs. That helps account for the wage differential between men and women, and Japan's low birth rate is in large part a function of an environment in which women must choose between a stable career and a family. Although Prime Minister Abe's economic policies, so-called Abenomics, are largely supported in the United States, over the mid to long term, we can predict that the rapid drop in population due to this low birth rate will result in a large decline in Japan's national power. When Abe-san returned as a prime minister, he announced to Japanese as well as to foreigners that it is women who can serve as savior of this declining nation, and help promise that by the year 2020, women will hold 30% of leadership position in Japan. That is a goal that the Gender Equality Bureau had originally announced back in the year 2003. Hillary Clinton once advised us that if all women in Japan remained in the workforce, Japan could expect an increase in GDP of 15-16%. Professor Elizabeth Moss Kantor of the Harvard Business School theorized that if a minority came to constitute 30% of a group, it would gain real influence over decision-making. Even though Japan has drafted a variety of action plans to reach Prime Minister Abe's target of 30%, 2020 is only 5 years away, and female politicians hold only about 10% of Diet seats and about 3% local assembly seats. Although it was the United States that initiated the modern women's liberation movement, there are not many female politicians here in comparison with the European Union. Even so, you have had female candidates for vice president, and of course, one woman now has a chance getting elected president. Japan lacks diversity and still fails to recognize its importance. Men who focused on the goal of economic growth in the 1970s are now leaders in their industries, but they refuse to recognize and cultivate women power. If Prime Minister Abe cannot keep his campaign promise to utilize women better, his government will not survive. Not only would the Liberal Democratic Party lose power, but more important, Japan might not be able to stand on its own two feet. Even if we can purchase wonderful military hardware from the United States, if our younger population continues to shrink, Japan might not be able to maintain its expanding responsibilities as a U.S. security partner. The United States lacks policies targeting a low birth rate, but you welcome immigrants and are able to maintain your military. It is difficult for Japan to adopt such ways. As a result, what we need to do right now is crack the glass ceiling may have built over our heads and allow women to unleash their potential and change the future. In politics, we have not been able to find an effective policy to increase the number of female politicians in Japan. I personally believe that it is time to consider a quota system to tackle this problem in Japan. Forgive me if I take a moment to talk about myself. After 10 years of infertility treatments, I traveled to Reno, Nevada, of course in the United States, to receive a donor egg. You see, in Japan, a woman cannot receive a donor egg unless she suffers from an illness. That is, women like me, who are healthy but cannot get pregnant, have to go overseas for the procedures. In any case, in January of 2011, at my age of 50, I gave birth to a boy named Masaki. I wish I could, you know, bring him here, but he is very busy schedule, so he can come with me. So I brought some pictures that you can see. Okay. Masaki was born with many congenital defects, such as heart defect, tetralogy of hollow, and so on. By the time he was 1 year old, he had already undergone 9 operations. During that period, he also suffered a stroke, so he cannot move his right arm or leg. Although we are told that he might die at any time, look, he is now 4 years and 5 months old, and he gives my husband and me a joy, hope, and surprise every day. Well, this is the picture when he was 3. We celebrate we call it Shichigo-san for kids, 7 years old, 5 years old, 3 years old. We celebrate kids to put the traditional costume on. It's supposed to be kimono. It's like Inca singers, right? Okay. Next, please. This is last year's too. I went to Washington, D.C. To have a business, and I brought this T-shirt for him, a souvenir. He loves this T-shirt. And he's not, probably he's not Republican, so anyway. Now you can see, we are told that he will never be able to stand up because of the stroke, stand up or walk. But now he can walk around the house and enjoy the outdoors. And you can see the throat. He has an, it's difficult to pronounce again, tracheotomy. So we are told that he will not be able to speak, but now he can say, Mom, Dad, and hi. And can change the... How to do this? Okay, this is recent picture I like most. And after a long painful period of infertility treatments and doubts, Masaki's birth came as a blessing, and his mere existence made me a stronger person. Japan is now preparing for the 2020 Tokyo Olympics and Paralympics, and I sit on the Tokyo Paralympics Committee of the Diet. At one of its meetings, we watched the P&G, Procter & Gamble TV commercials with the theme, Thank You, Mom. Do you know? I wish I could bring the film, but because of the right, I cannot show you today, but maybe you can check later on. Thank You, Mom. And I was so moved by the boy who had no leg, and then his mother supported very much. And as this commercial demonstrated, where women are strong, Japan will rejuvenate itself when women from different walks of life can realize their dreams and develop women power to the fullest extent. Maybe I can change the picture. Yeah. See, you Boston Red Sox, but my boy likes Japan Giants. Not my favorite team, though. Dad's favorite team. And he went to the stadium, and he could walk like this. Okay. And do you like this? This is the astronaut uniform I bought at the duty-free shop in the Washington airport. It fits well. And anyway, this is the end of the picture, so anyway. So I just repeat again. Women are strong. Japan will rejuvenate itself when women from different walks of life can realize their dreams and develop women power to the fullest extent. As a diet representative, I will continue my effort to realize my dream of a society in which all women can shine. Thank you for your time.
Our first panel, which is historical in focus, is moderated by Professor Susan Farr, who is the Edwin O. Reischauer Professor of Japanese Politics and Director of the Program on U.S.-Japan Relations here at Harvard, where she has also served as Chair of the Government Department and Associate Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. Among Professor Farr's many publications are the books Political Women in Japan and Losing Face, Status Politics in Japan. That sort of information you can find on her CV. The sort of information that you cannot find on her CV is the support that she has always given to her students. Professor Farr was my own advisor when I was a graduate student, and I think it's fair to say that I would not be here today were it not for her. So she has my special thanks, and I will leave it to her now.
Thank you so much, Frank, for those very kind words. It's a real privilege to me to be here today and to take part in, be a, really the host for this wonderful project that Showa has initiated and to join with the Reischauer Institute in sponsoring it. I look at the panel before you, and I can tell you that when I add up all the years I've known the people on this panel, it comes to 108 years, which is an amazing number. But I do have a very long association with each one. And let me simply say that the real purpose of this particular panel, of our two panels, is to give you the long-term perspective, over 70 years, of where Japanese women, where they have come from, and where they are today. In the next panel, we'll be looking in much more detail at exactly where things are now today in the workplace, in managerial situations, and in decision making. But this panel takes a very broad view. And its starting point, Bando-san has already given us a situation today in which, by whichever metric you use, the standing of Japanese women relative to the standing of women in other countries is really quite low. By the metric that Bando-san mentioned, 104 out of all the nations in the world, and by the metric that Estaves Abe will give you later from the World Bank gender statistics, 158 is rank out of 188 nations. Does this mean that the situation of Japanese women has gotten worse over these 70 years? Absolutely not. It means that around the world, women are coming up. In country after country, women are coming up. And of course, Japanese women have come up in many ways. And in some ways, they are ahead of women in other countries. And you've already had several of those ways mentioned. For one thing, compared with the United States, the US Constitution has no explicit guarantee of women's equality. But the Japanese Constitution has Article 14, which is such a guarantee. And there are other things as well in life expectancy. Japanese women outlive women in any other country in the world. They enjoy great prosperity because the nation of Japan, for all the concern today about the rise of China, whatever, Japan ranks very high in terms of lifestyle and comfort for living, and Japanese women have been the tremendous beneficiary of the rise of Japan. Plus, there are many, many outstanding women in Japan in global affairs as well as in the nation. You see three of them before you. I mentioned just another, Sadako Ogata, who we were privileged to give an honorary degree to at Harvard for her contribution for the as the High Commissioner for Refugees under the United Nations. So that's sort of the general background. Let me now introduce our panelists. You have their bios. And so with Bando-san, I will not say anything in detail, but maybe just point out that she has held positions which were a big splash every time she took a position. She was the first female career bureaucrat in the Japanese Prime Minister's office. She was, as a woman, the vice governor of Saitama Prefecture, and it was my honor to visit her in that post, and she had a huge amount of media coverage from that. She was prominent as in when she was appointed a consul general as a woman in Japan. She has been a trailblazer on many fronts, and she has, in a way that will inspire those of you who are academics in this room, she has written 40 books. You know how much work that is, and many of them really looked in detail. She's written her best-selling book is a book of advice to young women, but she's done many, many analytic books on the situation of women. So she will be our first panelist. Our second panelist is Sumiko Iwao, who has a PhD in sociology from Yale. She also taught at the Harvard Graduate School of Education, so she's well known to us here. We're very privileged to have her, and she is has played many prominent roles in Japan. And our third presenter, and I should say, Iwao-san will talk really about how women combine family and the work, looking over a long period of time. And our third presenter will deal with a very important topic, which is the role of the political system in creating the outcomes we have in Japan for women. She is Margarita Esteves Abe. She is now a professor of political science at Syracuse University and in the Maxwell School. And her field really is comparative political economy of gender. Formerly, she taught in the government department at Harvard. In my heart, she stands out because she was another of my students in addition to Frank, but it is a real privilege to be on the panel with her today. May I turn things over now to Bando-san.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Susan. How to describe my gratitude? Anyway, I am the first panel. It is a very difficult job to talk in 7 minutes about 70 years history of policies for women in Japan. But I will try. Okay, I'd like to divide the last 7 decades into 5 stages. The first stage consists of the occupation period. Liberal-minded American people like Beate Sirota, who sympathized with Japanese women, lack of equal rights, lead the way to the drastic change in Japanese constitution and the amendment of the civil code, basic law on education, labor standard act, and so on. But it would take time for attitude to change. The second stage consists of the period of high-speed economic growth. Many young people moved from farming in the countryside to cooperate employment in urban areas. And as nuclear, then multi-generation families became the norm. And the men go out to work and women stay home. Type of gender role became deeply ingrained. The Japanese-style welfare state gave husbands the role of breadwinners, and the wife became the caretakers. Men were hired as soon as they graduated from school, and they received on-the-job training, job rotation, and promotion according to seniorities, and were taken care of until they retired. Although male employees won inclusion in paternalistic companies in this way, when women were excluded, they worked as short-time employees without on-the-job training, job rotations, and promotion to executive positions. They were hired on the understanding that they would retire once they got married and had children. Policies for women in those days were policies for wives. Wives were given tax benefits, such as a spousal deduction and inheritance tax reception, and part of the social security system, like health insurance and pensions, were designed for household unit. And a dependent wife received special treatment as a so-called category 3 recipient. The third stage is consisted of effort to catch up to the international movement to promote gender equality. The United States made 1975 as International Women's Year and adopted the Convention on Eliminating of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. To ratify the International Convention, Japan passed an equal employment opportunity law, but it was weak because it lacked compulsory punishment of employers who failed to observe it. The Nationality Act was changed to acknowledge maternity as well as paternity. And boys started attending to the homemaking classes. But revision of the royal court governing the imperial family was not discussed at all. Civil society grows and very active from mid-1990s after the Hanshin earthquake. And 1997 saw passage of the law on non-profit activities. Long-term care insurance was established, and the Equal Employment Opportunity Law was revised to prohibit sexual harassment in the workplace. In 1999, the Basic Act for Gender Equal Society was promulgated and implemented. And 2001, we saw the establishment of the Bureau and Council for Gender Equality at Cabinet Office. And I'm so lucky to be the first Director General for Bureau of Gender Equality. And promulgation of the law to prevent domestic violence. This stage, we Japanese policy was improved to make the equality grassroots movement in civil society supported these developments. The fourth stage involved effort to counter the nation's falling birth rate. Almost all Japanese decision makers were shocked by the record-breaking low birth rate of 1.57 in 1989. So there are many, many policies. They are more eager to do something to raise the birth rate more than equality for gender. the child care leave law was passed in 1991, and Japan ratified Convention 156 of International Labor Organization. The Angel Plan was revised to improve daycares and other measures promoted the child care for new generations. The child care leave law was revised in 1995 and again in the year 2000, 2004, and 2009. Now, all the Japanese female employee can take 12 to 18 months of leave with 60% of income guaranteed covered by the insurance. They can also work shorter hours until their children reach the age of six. And fathers can take leaves too. Even so, still many non-regular workers are not guaranteed employment and fringe benefit. And during Mr. Abe's first term as Prime Minister, there was a backlash against policies to promote gender equality. The current fifth stage involves active participation by women. When Mr. Abe returned to power in 2012, he focused on strategies to stimulate economic growth and declared that women's participation is a key to vitalizing the Japanese economy, as Noda-san mentioned. He set a goal of increasing the proportion of women in a managerial position to 30% by 2020. A policy that had originally been suggested back in 2003 when I was the Director General of the Gender Equal Bureau. Prime Minister Abe asked the executives of major corporations to increase their number of female managers and board directors. And he submitted this diet bill to improve women's participation. But as I have mentioned, American women and policies have had a great impact on improving gender equality in Japan. And we have also learned policies to help women keep their jobs from the welfare state of Scandinavian and other policies from the United Nations or ILO. But I think the most important and difficult obstacle we now face is the success previously enjoyed by the Japanese economy and management system. We women must offer different vision of success for the future, not only the economy. And we can cooperate with our American sisters, not only ensure the success of Japanese economy and system of management, but we must make this entire world better place to live, to enjoy equality and peace. That's my hope. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let me turn things over now to Professor Iwao.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great honor to be invited, and I'm very happy to be back at Harvard. The assignment I received from Bando-san is to cover the area of Japanese women's attitudes, especially on marriage and family. And I shall be quoting various survey results without mentioning their sources for the time's sake. Now, before presenting some data to see the trend, let me characterize the changes Firstly, I would say that change means from a must to an option and has resulted in multiplicity. Therefore, making generalizations have become quite difficult. Secondly, the prolonged severe economic situation has left a strong impact upon Japanese, and it has strengthened the women's inclination towards pragmatic thinking rather than orientation towards the principle of gender equality. As overall background information, let me show you how Japanese attitudes towards traditional sex roles have or have not changed. We can see from this slide covering between 1979 and 2014 that women support the traditional sex roles less than men. However, I cannot help expressing a sense of surprise that this many women, over 40%, still support the traditional sex roles, that is, women's place is in the home. Although younger men and women support this idea, less than older generation. But in actuality, since 1997, the number of families with both husband and wife working supersedes the number of households with only the husband working. There used to be socially prescribed expectations or life goals which fit the majority of women in Japan. But today, any life course is more or less acceptable. For example, marriage during a certain age period used to be a must for most people, but it has become an option and is left up to individual choice and preference. Therefore, responsibilities, risks, and accompanying anxiety involved in the choices that he or she has to bear has become greater, thus making decision-making harder and taking longer, as reflected in the average age of the first marriage. Because Japanese people are marrying later, the average age of mother when the first child is born is getting older, which is one of the causes of low fertility rate. But low fertility does not mean that children are not so important as they used to be. On the contrary, it appears that due to a smaller number of children they actually have than the number they wish to have, the greater the place children occupy in the parents' mind. Here I should also add that having no children is no longer a target of social stigma. Although still a small minority, increasing numbers of both men and women have no intention to marry. The majority, however, nearly 90% of single men and women express their intention or desire to marry, yet many do not or cannot marry till late. What are the reasons behind this? Since marriage has become an option, many do not feel strong pressure to get married. At the same time, single men and women older than 25 give not having met suitable partner as the major reason for not marrying. As for the requirement for a marriage partner, good personality is the top priority for both men and women, and it is followed by the housework and parenting skills. It seems love is no longer blind, and the decision to marry seems to be made after deliberately contemplating over the shopping list for a suitable partner. And I don't know how you can judge if the potential husband has appropriate housework and parenting skills before marrying. But are these requirements met after they marry and have children? The amount of time Japanese men spend for household activities is still quite small. How do Japanese women react to the reality? Even for ideal amount of sharing childcare, Japanese women are not demanding a 50-50 share between the couple. Their husbands think 40-60 share should be good enough. But when it comes to the actual amount of sharing, the husband's share perceived by wives are less than 30%. Next, let's look at the issues of women's life courses. Both men and women seem to favor that women should leave work when children are small and return to work when children need less care. And it is the I hope you can see. However, we should note that an increasing number of men expect women to continue working as if to say that they cannot afford to have a full-time homemaker, and women's contribution to family finances is needed and expected. If you look at women's ideal life course, nearly 20%, here you can see in the red, of women want to be a full-time homemaker. But in actuality, women realize that they won't be allowed to have the luxury of becoming a full-time homemaker. So you can see only 8.7% here. So many Japanese women have lost the freedom not to work. As a result, women need to be expert jugglers, managing work, childcare, household chores, elder care, and so on, which obviously demands much reform at the workplace to ease their juggling. It seems that many women today want to maintain balance among child rearing, work, hobbies, networking with friends, and so on, which they consider important in life rather than an aspiration to shine in society. The fact that women are still keeping the home and purse strings under their control may be contributing to their attitudes. Also, they do not envy men's lifestyle of long working hours and not having enough time at home to enjoy family life. So lots of reform are needed. And I think in the second session, we'll continue discussing what can we do for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We'll now turn things over to Professor Estaves Abe.
So it's my great pleasure to be here today, and I'd like to express my gratitude to the organizers, Bando Sensei, Frank Schwartz, and my mentor, Susan Farr, and I would just second everything that Frank had said about Susan. And I also like to extend my thanks to our Consul General for a very warm welcome last evening. So I'll be speaking about female political representation in Japan. So it's just a great pleasure to have Representative sort of Seiko Noda here, because I'm just a scholar, but she lives the reality of it every day. So I will just turn some of my... I actually have some sort of questions to her, so I'll just come to that at the very end of my slides. So I have a rather sort of depressing title, A Dismal State of Affairs. Okay. So Susan has already just quoted some of the numbers. On this slide, I just couldn't include all 188 countries, so I've only included OECD countries, and it's always very easy to find Japan. Just look at the bottom of the figure. And I just want to just highlight sort of some issues. It might be a little sort of difficult, but the US doesn't have much to brag about either. So the US is down there too. And I just want to flag some more countries. This is Korea, So this is the US. And at the very high end, among together with Scandinavian countries, you'll find Spain. So I want you to remember the US, Korea, Spain as comparisons, because I will be just coming back to those issues. Okay, so where Japan stands, just, comparatively not great, but there have been changes in Japan. Japan changed its electoral system in 1994, and the first elections, lower house elections under the new system took place in 1996. And the new electoral system is a mixed system, but very importantly, Japan introduced a proportional representation tier. And as I will just come back later, proportional representation tier is considered to be a very women-friendly electoral system. But the point here is, as I will just show in the next slide, despite the introduction of the PR tier, the numbers in Japan hasn't really improved very much. Okay. And another thing, I asked you to just focus on where the US stood in the first figure. So the US doesn't do well either, that when you just look at Congress or the Senate, the percentage of women in the US politics is just quite small. But this is not the case when you look at subnational levels in the US. Whereas, again, I will just show you a sort of different slide. In Japan, the percentage of women is low at any level of government. In the US, perhaps not elected officials, but because of the political appointment system, in the US, you do see women in high government position. Not really the case in Japan. And two other countries, sort of Spain and Korea. So Korea is kind of getting better than Japan. So changes are happening faster. And changes took very fast in a country like Spain. Spain used to be like Japan, very male chauvinistic. And because of sort of Franco period, in up to the mid 70s, a married woman needed a written consent from their husbands in order to be able to work for pay. But today, when you just look at political representation of women, Spain does as well as Scandinavian countries, meaning that there's almost an equal representation of women in the parliament. So which means that changes can happen. So this is the historical view of female political representation in post-war Japan. So the numbers in the horizontal axis is it just shows the number of lower house elections that took place in Japan. And some sort of highlights. So the first square is the first election that took place under the new electoral system. So you see that the numbers didn't dramatically sort of improve, but you just see this upward sort of trend. So one could see that maybe the introduction of the PR tier did something to the system. But then again, you have to remember, when you just look at this figure, you might just get a false impression that Japan's really changing. So you have to place this in the comparative context. But even with this increase, Japan's still at the bottom of the international trend. So this is the percentage of women in subnational level political office. So governors, so mayors with two asterisks. So these are mayors of large sort of cities, government decreed cities. And interesting, there are more women, female sort of mayors in bigger urban sort of subnational units than in mayors of townships and just smaller places. And the percentage of women in municipal parliaments is not that much higher. And this is a very unique trend, because in most countries, one finds more women in subnational subnational parliaments. In Japan, that's not the case, because in rural areas, the number of women actually goes down. So what affects the number of women in parliament? Is it culture? Is it electoral rules? Or is it whether you have gender quota or not? Professor Iwao has just talked about cultural trends in Japan when it comes to gender roles. But then, you know, so culture doesn't really explain everything, because in terms of cultural, you know, the culture has sort of changed in Japan, and also culturally, you know, Japan's similar to Korea. But then Korea has just managed to change more rapidly than Japan. And in fact, when we just compare views of the family or gender roles, the US is much more conservative than you know, most European countries. So on so many questions, Japan's not that far away from the US, but still we don't see too many Japanese women in high sort of government positions. So what's Japan's problem? And sorry about this slide, it just suddenly, I just wanted to sort of pack too much so the font gets smaller. But you know, here there are two sort of messages. Party competition is very important. It's not just PR. Having a proportional representation helps, but only when parties compete on having women. So how does this happen? So in many countries in Europe, countries that have proportional representation, some small parties, or either, you know, one of the small parties on the left typically, or one of the big parties recruits women to run for office, and they do well electorally. And once this happens, there's a kind of spillover. You know, parties want to increase seats. So when they think that gender diversity helps them electorally, then they rush to do it. So that's what happened in Spain. So it has started on the left, but the Conservative Party just immediately sort of bandwagoned on it. So they just both de facto, so there was no government quota, gender quota, but then the number of women just almost immediately sort of increased. And also Spain does have a proportional representation system with a closed party list, where the party leadership can actually just change the party list overnight by putting men and women alternatively, like, you know, on the party list. So in Japan, although there is a proportional representation, there has been, gender diversity hasn't really been a very important electoral strategy, at least for major parties. Smaller ideological parties have performed much better when it comes to gender diversity. So social democrats, communists, they tend to have more women, but they are too small to kind of threaten big political parties. And this is just one of the reasons why nothing much is happening on the gender front in Japanese parliament. So two things: party competition and types of political parties. Ideologically close-knit parties tend to have strong party leadership, so the party leaders can affect who runs. In a party like Liberal Democratic Party, Representative Noda could just tell us more about that. But you know, when the party's not that cohesive as an organizational structure, it's very difficult to promote women, especially when you have single member district. And this happens in the US too. So instead of just me just talking about the final sort of two things, I just wanted to turn them into more like sort of questions to Representative Noda. The Japanese style, the sort of conservative style of electoral campaigning, where you have to just service your constituency, that's really time consuming. And also in Japan, elections are so frequent. And again, for Americans, this is no big surprise. So one should never ever compare only Japan and the US, because the US, let's admit it, it's a strange place. Right? So in the US, there are elections every 2 years. No other country but Japan has a system like that. And in Japan, at least in the US Congress, the term is 2 years. In Japan, in the lower house, they have a term of 4 years, but they never ever wait for the full term. So when you just look at the post-war period in Japan, so there are national elections either every other year or sometimes every year. So this places an enormous burden on individual candidates to maintain their sort of constituency. And this probably just isn't really compatible with motherhood. So that's just one thing I just wanted to sort of raise. And another thing, Japan has introduced proportional representation system, So how come that it's not really working as well as it should? Well, I already said that it's sort of party competition, but there was a party competition. So before the DPJ took power, the kind of the party competition was increasing in Japan. So that would have been a chance for Japan to increase the number of women. Why didn't it happen? That's because the Japanese political parties use the mixed system in ways that they shouldn't, meaning that their party list on the proportional representation list all those candidates that are running from the single member districts. So despite the fact that the electoral system now allows them to use proportional representation party list in an effective way to increase the number of women, they haven't been able to do that because of this dual listing. So I'll just end here, and because I also just want to hear what Representative Noda thinks about this sort of dual listing and the number of female candidates. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much. And we now have a nice period of time for questions. And I hope that you will feel free to be far-ranging in your questions. May I ask you, when you do to have a question, if you could mention who you are, introduce yourself, including any affiliation you might have outside of Harvard, if you happen to be here as a visitor. And from the standpoint of time, I'd appreciate it if you would keep your questions short and one question per questioner. So who would like to start? Yes, Ted Gilman of the Reischer Institute.
Ted Gilman of the Reischer Institute. Thank you all for this great panel. It hangs together very well. I wanted to ask, I noticed looking at the bios, for example, Bando Sensei had spent some time as a career bureaucrat, and the conversation here, the presentations here weighed heavily toward the political side of things and the low number of women in political positions. But could any of you comment on the number of women in bureaucratic jobs and the effect that they can have on policy and issues that interest women? Thanks.
Bando-san, would you like to speak to that?
Yes. I believe Japanese women bureaucrats make many jobs, like the equal employment opportunities, child care leave law, or anti-domestic violence law, such. But I'm afraid we made the legislation laws, but it is not ingrained to the people's attitude. It does not come from the real voices from grassroots I'd like to say politicians in powerful position are not so much serious to improve the equality of women. As I mentioned, they are very much supportive to improve the status of wives or to help the working mothers, but not the equality. But that's the case, I'm afraid. We cannot change, we bureaucrats cannot change.
Could I follow that up with a question? Because the goal that Prime Minister Abe has set for 2020 calls for having 30% of women in leadership positions. What is the bureaucracy doing to try to move towards that goal in these 5 years that remain?
Bureaucrats have a very strong seniority systems. Mm-hmm. So it takes nearly 15 years mm-hmm. to be the manager. Mm-hmm. And after 2003, mm-hmm. The recruitment of women for bureaucrats bureaucracy is increasing. But this year, it was 31.6% or something like that.
Of the incoming people into the bureaucracy,
31%. But not yet managerial level, but the number is growing. And maybe after 5 years, 10 years, I believe it will be nearly 20%, mm-hmm. not 30%.
Okay. Next question. Yes.
Hi, Hi, I'm Keiko Hirao. Thank you very much for wonderful presentations. It seems that in retrospect, that the Japanese woman's status has really, really improved. And what's happening right now is changing the ideological, you know, argument, economic argument, making that women, you know, working in a labor force would, you know, profit the country and so on. But what is happening right now, after the 2008, is not really the breaking of the glass ceiling, but instead breaking down of the males, you know, dobuita. Garasu no tenjo dewa naku dobuita. So, gender equality seemed to be reached at the bottom of the social status scale. But yet, you know, people seem to be so excited about Abe's women mix. But I would like to hear your comments about these terms used in this discourse is very sexist. For example, Abe, Prime Minister, initially began with jose no katsuyo, which is a transitive verb with subject and object. If you have woman katsuyo suru, jose o katsuyo suru, and you have to have a subject different than women. But people do not seem to talk about that kind of thing.
Could you mention your affiliation?
Sorry. I'm Keiko Hirao from Sophia University. I'm visiting here.
Who would like to respond to
this? I think we now changed the katsuyo to katsuyaku. Josei katsuyaku hoan, bill, which Abe cabinet is now preparing for the diet, is josei katsuyaku hoan, or Women Shining Society. So they're concerning the word, but.
Period. Okay. Would one of you, would you like to comment as well?
Well, many women that I have interviewed before coming over here in the of my former students and so on, and many of them sort of felt that it was a bad taste saying that katsuyo, I mean, using, meaning that to utilize women for the sake of economic growth and so on. And they were quite uncomfortable. And then they are saying that we don't want to be involved in this women shine society kind of thing. I like to be concerned with my own family and how I'm keeping balance of all the things that I want to do. And I'm more concerned about my own happiness and so on. And then it seems that they are more and more focusing to their rather narrow area, rather than those sort of societal movement kind of, you know, leveling up women's status. They would not like to be involved.
Would you like to comment?
Yes, just one sort of issue. Yes, I think that the mistrust of the government also just comes from the fact that the sort of female, you know, so female sort of politicians who've been sort of promoted under the current government just don't tend to be sort of feminists. So maybe there's a level of sort of mistrust from women. But aside from that, I just want to just put sort of Japan into perspective, because just some people just seem to just think that when the government wants to unleash sort of women's sort of manpower for economic reasons, that there's just it's suspicious. I mean, it shouldn't be just considered that way. And you know, in fact, in many European countries too. So you know, as the economy is changing and as the demographic structures are changing, there really is a need to activate more fully women, particularly mothers, especially if they're highly educated. And in Japan, there are lots of highly educated women who are not fully sort of activated in the labor market. So even in European countries too, you know, Scandinavian countries or just other Northern European countries in the past 10 years or so have introduced policies aiming at more fully activating highly educated mothers. So So there are certain things that are happening under sort of Abe government, but there also is, you know, there is a sort of general trend that wealthy aging societies are just are kind of you know, carrying out.
Mm-hmm. Daniel Smith of the Government Department.
Thank you. I'm Dan Smith from the Government Department. I work on elections and candidate recruitment and dynasties and women as well. So I have a question for Margarita Estevez Abe about supply. There's an argument by Ethan Shiner, who's a political scientist, that one of the reasons why the DPJ failed for so long to compete against the LDP was because of a lack of quality candidates. And you get quality candidates from having local politicians or bureaucrats. And there's a similar story that is coming to mind with women, where the number of female candidates at the local level is so low, women are not in high-profile bureaucratic positions as well. So actually, from 1980 to 1993, the LDP recruited and nominated a total of four female candidates. Four. Three of the four came from political dynasties. So actually, dynastic politics is one way that women can get through in this otherwise poor supply of female candidates. So are there any discussions about how, through institutional reform or otherwise, to increase the supply of a pool of qualified female candidates so that, you know, in a few years down, there will be more at the national level?
Well, you know, that's why, you know, party competition is important, right? Just sort of, so Ethan has just talked about how sort of local politics not that sort of competitive, because if you are a rural sort of constituency, you just want someone who's in the ruling party so that you can just get money. And I think that's what explains the lack of women in local politics in Japan, because this is not like in other sort of countries. So supply, so politics really have to change, right? So once there are sort of frequent changes of power at the national level, maybe things would, because otherwise it would be just very sort of difficult to just think about how the supply. You see, the parties have to be, so big parties have to be under an electoral pressure to want to just recruit more women. They just don't do that just out of blue. You know, in all the other countries where the number of women just increased, there was kind of electoral competition context. So this is not just something that we can, well, the government might be able to impose quota. You know, since at the national level at least, because the Japanese government provides political parties with extremely generous subsidies, you could say, we'll cut the subsidies if you don't recruit more sort of female candidates. I don't know whether that would just lead to the high quality of candidates. But, you know, the fact that just so many highly educated Japanese women just withdraw to family life and find it difficult to get back into the good tier of labor market, I think that there must be lots of rights. Yeah, I think that would be a very good thing. You know, the local level, you know, graduate students, because at the local level, the pay is good. The Japanese politicians get paid really well, like the American ones. So I think just more people, you know, since the labor market prospects are just dwindling for young people, you know, maybe they should just run for local office, and maybe there should be a campaign. But no, the current government's just of course not interested in doing a campaign like that.
Perhaps this is a good time for a question for Noda-san. Noda-san, could we ask a question? And then, fortunately, the microphone is near you. And my question is this, because Prime Minister Abe has set a target of 30% of women in leadership positions by 2020, we would think in the LDP, in the Juminto itself, that should mean that one-third of cabinet positions should be female, and that one-third of candidates should be female, and one-third of people in leadership positions in the party should be female, that would be a target to support the prime minister's goal. What do you think?
Well, it is a target, but it can be possible to make it for LDP, because as I mentioned, that we only have 10% of the 10% of the all the diet members, and also this is a fact that when LDP wins a lot, gains a seat, women loses the number in Japan's diet. So the LDP is the cause of the reason that we can't gain the women's seats. And the character of the LDP is different from other minority parties because we have no specific sponsors to support the election campaign. So each candidate has to solve the financial problems. Like we have to, you know, we have no special sponsors to donate the monies, and so it is us the candidate to collect the money. And usually man is easier than women to collect money from the public or you know, in the society or companies, because women mistrust you know, especially the company people don't trust us. They trust male candidate and not trust a female candidate. Therefore, they don't give us money. So it is difficult for women to keep on, you know, working on the election campaign because of the financial problem. Also, LDP, we have a name list of the candidates. It's full of men. So many men want to be a candidate of LDP election. So it is so difficult us women to get into it. And therefore, I suggest the quota system. It's a force, a party to open up the seats for women. Because otherwise, I don't have any idea that LDP will be able to gain the women's seats.
Mm-hmm. Has there been talk of subsidizing women candidates to help them with the financial barrier that you mentioned?
Well, my case, the financial problem is very hard. You see, this, for instance, usually we hire about 10 secretaries, and out of three, the government pays, but the other seven secretaries' salary I have to pay for. So it is so difficult for a mere woman to collect money, like it's a huge amount of money. So usually, someone mentioned that the woman representative is from like a politician's family, like Ms. Obuchi and Ms. Tanaka, and they are the rich family of the politician. Therefore, they could manage the running the offices. And so once, and it is not so easy to become a politician. Maybe many women experience one election and fail, and they cannot keep doing it because of the financial support. They won't be able to get it because of the a female. Then people don't trust the female candidate for a long time. And also, she mentioned about the utilization of the women. Well, it's true because please let me excuse first. Ms. Abe-san is the first, very first person, the prime minister of LDP who declared the woman is great, right? After 70 years. Mostly, the leader of the politician political war in Japan is from LDP, but probably he was the only and the first one to speak up about the ability of women as a political issue. So, but as you know, he is not the feminist. He likes housewives. He doesn't abridge the housewives, you know, the tax reduction. Well, anyway, he mentally or spiritually or whatever trust women, but rather according to the rebuild the economy of Japan stronger, and then women's power is one of the unit to construct the rebuild the economy stronger. So, But anyway, this is the first time that us women as a kind of a star issue in Japanese politics, I think. So maybe we can see. But it is so, so difficult to make it by 2020 to the target. So I don't know what Abe-san wants to do. But recently, he changes the subject from women to local, right? In the last election, the first election that he reentered the prime minister, the first issue was the women's issue, the activate the women's power for Japan to rebuild the Japan strong. But previous election of December last year, the first title was rebuild the local something, and changed to so the women's issues is number two. So maybe it seems to me it's very difficult to complete the target of 30%. But we have to do something more. I don't know what to do. I presented that the idea of quota is so drastic and very hard, but it's effective to the Japanese political system, and I don't have any other idea to make our politicians to 30%.
And quotas are, in fact, widely used in Europe as a way to get more women legislators. Do you want to mention that point? Because many people in the U.S. may not know that so much.
Yeah, well, Korea has introduced the quota. No, so in the U.S., you know, because of the, you know, when you have a proportional representation system, you could just have, you know, the part, you know, there are two types of quotas. One quota is the one that the government imposes on political parties, and sometimes political parties adopt a quota on their own. So then,
women.
So you have to think a different way. Mm. Or maybe it would be a promises for the parties that the half of the candidates should.
No, but yeah, because of this dual listing, you know, Japan cannot do that. Yeah.
Naoto-san, could I just ask you, because you've been in the Diet for 23 years, and you've had many prime ministers. So are you saying that Abe-san is the best prime minister from the standpoint of women? Because you said he already changed his priority and now dropped women to the number two position. What do you think?
Well, it is quite difficult to answer because some of the prime ministers who chose me up, the cabinet members, one of the best. and also Abe-san chose me anyway. I cannot say until he achieved the promises, mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. women issues. Mm-hmm. It's on the way now. So as well as Abenomics. It's just on the way, so I don't know see the result. Mm-hmm. When I see the result that he could make it, he would be the best. But I cannot say now because it's on the way, and I don't know what's going on. Mm-hmm. So, but I think Obuchi-san is my good. Favorite. Uh-huh. But because made the
basic law for gender equality.
Yes, yes.
Society.
Then you are the first manager of that, yeah. Right?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I want to make sure the audience, has a chance to get into this conversation. Yes.
Hi, David James with the United States Japan Foundation. I had a question about...
Just from New York.
Yes, from New York to see you, Susan, and everyone else. I had a question about women in the nonprofit sector in Japan. You've spoken a lot about women's leadership in the political sphere and in the business sector. From where I sit at the U.S.-Japan Foundation, I've seen dramatic growth in the number of nonprofit organizations in Japan, the culture of philanthropy in Japan, and I've been really... very proud to see a number of Japanese women form and lead very well-known Japanese NPOs. For example, Katariba by Kumi Imamura, who won Nikkei Woman of the Year a number of years ago. Beyond Tomorrow, a nonprofit formed after the 3/11 disaster run by Minami Tsubouchi. There's a number of others. Lynn Kobayashi, who just founded Japan's perhaps first international boarding high school, International School of Asia in Karuizawa. So I'm very impressed by what Japanese women are doing in that sector, and I'd like to hear if you share that impression, that is a valuable sector that women can really shine in, or is it a sector that really, in fact, very few women, and I'm only looking at just a small percentage. I'd like to hear your comments.
Who would like to answer that?
Yes, there are many women who are active in non-profit organizations, as you mentioned. And I believe many women want to contribute more non-profit activities than make money. Men so much pursue money or status or power. I'm afraid it's not only Japan, but women are more eager to work for society, to work for something good, not for money, not for power. I hope this is a good point for women to participate for the societies. Of course, many of women give up to change the societies. Many women want to stay home to enjoy their private life more than to contribute for societies. Yes, but still, not majority, but many women want to participate for better activities to change the societies. That's my dream, my hope.
Dr. Iwao is actually very active and has her own NGO in which she's raising money for a school in Tanzania. And would you like to comment on this point?
I'm just one example of founding an NGO myself. And you know, the reason why women are quite active in organizing NGO or participating in NGO, NPO activities are because there's no seniority or, you know, much of organization and there's not much money at all. And that's why women can afford, in a sense, that there's no competition because men usually are not interested much in the, you know, organization without any money. And so I'm having very hard time trying to start this school in Tanzania. But and actually, the two of my major donors are women who have given money. And one said that because she doesn't have any children, and she doesn't need to leave any money, and then she's not going to have any graves in Japan. So she doesn't need to save money. So she gave me the money to build a library at this school called Sakura Girls Secondary School in Tanzania at the foot of Kilimanjaro.
Thank you.
So I would appreciate anybody who'd be interested.
We're going to take up a donation at the end.
Yes. So I think, again, you know, there's a very important difference between NPOs in the U.S. and NPOs in Japan, as you know, Professor Iwao just mentioned. NPOs in Japan don't really have paid staff, whereas in the U.S., the nonprofit sector is just sort of quite huge and employs a lot of people employs a lot of salaried people. And just lots of women just find it very, it's a very sort of family-friendly sort of environment for lots of women to work. So say female lawyers might just decide to just work for an NPO instead of just joining a corporate law firm because of, you know, better working conditions. So Japan hasn't got there, but if Japan finds a way to have American-style NPOs, maybe that's, you know, that just increases sort of good job opportunities for women. But at the moment, nonetheless, even when these NPOs are not paid, and many of the women who are just leading these NPOs or volunteering for these NPOs are being financed by their husbands, you know, so, but even in that case, I think, you know, in terms of thinking about politics and the pipeline of women, because this would be just a very good way for housewives to engage in, you know, in sort of things sort of beyond their family and get sort of expertise in organizing, leading, you know, contacting, and these people could then just run for office if there are sort of political parties that would sort of recruit them. And in fact, a very important sort of example of this is Seikatsusha Network. So this is a co-op, and just many of the women who just got involved in this co-op were just volunteers. Highly educated women. So now the equivalent sort of supply of women might be sort of declining in Japan. But so this Seikatsusha Network, you know, this just became sort of pretty big in sort of 80s and 1990s. And I interviewed some of these women. They were just highly, highly educated, extremely competent people. In the US, they would be working in the corporate sector. But because they wanted to become mothers, and also, you know, there's not much training about controlling one's reproductive life in Japan. So so many of these little women, slightly older generation, getting married meant that uncontrolled timing for motherhood. But once their children sort of grew up, they just started working for these co-ops, and some of them became politicians through Seikatsusha Network because they became a local political party and then started to sort of cooperate with DPJ. So some of these sort of women that I met ended up just becoming sort of diet members sort of later on. So one sort of important point, you know, so there are all these sort of pieces that have to work together, and it's just not quite there yet in Japan.
And I would add, from a comparative standpoint, that in many countries, the pathway into politics is through gaining experience in a not-for-profit organization in which you gain, among other things, the fundraising skills that you say you need in politics. People get that in NGOs. Let's see, who else would like to? Yes.
Thank you, Susan. My name is Atsuko Fish. I run Small Family Foundation, Fish Family Foundation. And it is very interesting to listen panelists comment about the nonprofit in Japan. Obviously, in Japan, unfortunately, nonprofit system has not developed yet because taxation. And in America, nonprofit, they know how to raise money. They can write the grant and get the money, and then someone like our foundation, if we give money, that tax deductible. So my husband thinks, instead of paying tax, why don't we give our money to something useful? And I think that the one third of the money making system, I think in America, is nonprofit. And nonprofit in America is very powerful, as a matter of fact, because they government is not perfect, and there is a certain area, local elderly or children, or there are so many areas. Government cannot work on all the small details where nonprofit comes in and then working in America. So they are very powerful. And government and nonprofit working together, the area government cannot do. USAID is happy to give a grant, and nonprofit proposed to this is what need to be done in the community, in society, and USAID happy to hear those proposal. So I think in America, nonprofit is one of the most
powerful sector. Yes, maybe salary is not high as well as Wall Street people, but I think in America, average 70-80% of the profit organization they are making, not like in Japan. Japan maybe $1,000 per month. How can you survive? And then also, I think the CEO of the nonprofit in America, many powerful men is sitting there. They find it. There is a interesting achievement rather than making huge money. That's the choice of your life. What can you contribute to the society? What can you do to other people? So this is, I think it's a powerful thing. And hopefully Japan taxation, actually government hoping taxation system will change, then there is a huge possibility Japan women can work, or even the men can work there. Thank you.
The Japanese taxation system has been changing and has become a little more friendlier towards NPO. For example, in my case, I applied Japan Foundation, and Japan Foundation, if I collect donations which promote understanding between Japan and Tanzania, for example, then they would take care of the tax issues. So I think that the donor can get a tax exemption by or privilege by giving money through this, but it is still very difficult.
Yeah, excuse me, I'd love to go on with this topic, but I think we should get back to women, and I want to make sure that I have a chance for, thank you so much, but for one more question before we have to bring things to an end. Yes, there in the back.
Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. My name is Koichi Hagimoto, from, I'm at Wellesley College. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on the role of higher education in Japan. Two topics that I'm interested in. The first one is the so-called internationalization of Japan. And the second one is the one I'm more directly involved in, which is the declining number of not just Japanese, you know, female students, but male students going abroad to study or having some kind of experience and knowledge, you know, bringing back to Japan. So I was wondering if you you could talk about the topic.
If you could comment, but since our focus is women, you might want to also bring in how international studies affect women's opportunities. Would someone like to comment? Would someone like to reply?
I think in Japan, most of the corporation executive interested in so-called globalizations. And you know, we, Japan, don't have the enough number of the people who work such a global arenas. So once women can get such an education outside Japan, I think they have more opportunities nowadays. More than two decades ago, most of the women who get education outside Japan have very difficult to get a job for Japanese companies. Many women get a job at so-called foreign company, like Goldman Sachs, Boston Consulting Group, something like that. No traditional Japanese company accepts women who are more Americanized. But now they begin to change. They really understand the needs to have more globalized players. And also they understand diversity of their employee is very important to going to global arena. Thank you very much.
So we had a good point to really move into our next panel, which will get more at the current situation in Japan. I'm sure this topic will come up again. Let me close by thanking all our panelists and turning things over to our next moderator.